if you would, because I just want to bring in author and journalist Jürgen Todenhoefer. He has spent some time with Islamic State, 10 days in fact, embedded with the militant fighters in Iraq and Syria last year. Joins us now via Skype from Munich. Thank you so much for joining us on Sky News this afternoon. I heard you were speaking on the radio about this very subject last week. And I wonder if you could first of all tell us, in your opinion, what Islamic State wants the West to do? What would they like us to do, do you think?
Oh, they would love to see American or British ground troops in the Islamic State because they want to fight Western troops. They don't want to kill Muslims anymore. They are only killing Muslims, or most of their victims are Muslims. They want to fight against the champions. Champion is the Americans and the British and also the French people. They want to fight against the world, the Western world.
So they want Western forces to be on the ground. What about bombing, airstrikes? How do you think they would react to that?
They don't fear airstrikes because airstrikes are not successful. We have seen in Afghanistan, we have been bombarding Afghanistan for 14 years and the Taliban are still as strong as they have been 14 years ago. So it's not successful, but it was counterproductive. We had, when we started the war on terror, we had some hundreds of terrorists in the caves of the Hindu Kush, and now we have 100,000. Because for every child we kill with our bombs, we have 10 new terrorists. Bombing is a terror breeding program, and they know it, and therefore they're happy if we are bombarding.
What, if they don't fear airstrikes and they don't fear ground forces, what do they fear?
I think they would have problems if you would do three things. If we would stop the delivery of weapons and arms from the Gulf states, Saudi Arabia, etc., to the terrorists, to Al-Qaeda and troops like that in Syria, they would have problems if we would close the border between Turkey and the Islamic State, because every day some 100 or 200 fresh fighters from Western countries or from other parts of the world are crossing this border. I've been crossing this border too, not as a fighter, but as an observer. They would have big problems if they wouldn't get fresh fighters. And they can only fight and they can only survive because they have made a cooperation with those groups of the Iraqi and Syrian population which are excluded from the political process. I'm talking about the Sunnis, for example, in Iraq. The Sunnis have been excluded after the American invasion in 2003 completely, and therefore they are tolerating IS. And if you would succeed in creating a national reconciliation in Iraq and to make peace in Iraq, and if we would be successful to have a national reconciliation also in Syria between the regime and some of the rebels, some parts of the population, and if we would have peace in Syria, this would be a big problem because they would be finished like a fish without water. Guerrillas need a part of the population supporting them. And we should do everything to get this national reconciliation in Iraq and in Syria. And this would be a strategy which would be very dangerous.
What about the 70,000 troops on the ground that our Prime Minister has spoken so much about of late? How intimidating, how threatening, what might they be able to bring to threaten Islamic State?
You are talking about which troops? The troops of Assad or
No. So the British government, as far as our Prime Minister is concerned, when he was speaking to the House of Commons last week, he talked about 70,000 troops, pro-Syrian army troops, who would be able to be brought together, not necessarily under one banner, but at the present they are rebels in varying parts of the country. They could be brought together to fight Islamic State.
I don't see this 70,000 effective fighters fighting the Islamic State. I don't see them. I see only Iraqis unified Iraqis and unified Syrians fighting against IS, and the rest of all these armies and all these discussions will not solve the problem. I think we don't have up to now really a strategy to defeat ISIS, and we should have a strategy, and it should be a political strategy, because ISIS is extremely dangerous. For me personally, it's the most dangerous terror group in humankind history. They are incredible because it's a combination of fanatism and military drill, and that's a dangerous, very dangerous combination.
I wondered if I might be able to talk to you about your time when you were embedded with Islamic State. That our Prime Minister has referred to them as a death cult. How would you describe them?
The IS fighters?
Yes.
For me, they are criminals. For me, they are terrorists, but they are un-Islamic terrorists. Whatever they do has nothing to do with Islam, because Islam doesn't allow compulsion in religion. They force people to believe what they believe. Islam doesn't allow to kill innocents. They kill innocents every day. Islam doesn't allow to destroy churches, synagogues, or mosques. That's what they are doing every day. So it's an un-Islamic terrorist movement, which is extremely brutal. But the fact that they are very brutal is their strategy, because they want to spread fear among their enemies, and they want to provoke us to do silly things. And we have done silly things in Afghanistan. We have done unacceptable things. I'm a former judge, unacceptable things in Iraq, and they want to provoke us to do similar things. And they want to have to disperse, to destroy the friendship between Muslims and non-Muslims in the Western countries. And we shouldn't fall in their trap.
Jürgen, I wonder if I can ask you about the time that you spent with Islamic State. First of all, we have seen what they have done to Westerners over the last 18 months, 2 years. So I wonder about your emotions as you went to spend time with them. And also, what did you see while you were there?
I saw many things. I had a list, and I would say 70% of the things I wanted to see, I could see. And I saw horrible things. I saw a Kurdish hostage, and I spoke to him. And these are moments I will never forget, how helpless this man was. When I came back, I tried to do something for him, but it was not possible. I tried to have the opportunity to speak to John Cantley. They gave me the opportunity to speak to him, but they said they would film it. And I said, I cannot appear in a propaganda film of IS, of ISIS. But they were ready to bring me together with John Cantley, and they said he had prepared a letter for his family and a letter for David Cameron. I tried to contact your government when I came back, but your government refused to do anything and told me that I could step out of this question. I think it's a pity, because they were ready to give freedom to John Cantley at a not for much money. They asked the release of a not very important woman. So there was a possibility, but I was told not to stay in this problem. And for example, I spoke to a judge. I have been on many places. It's difficult to tell the whole story of 10 days. But I spoke to a judge about the executions and amputations. And I said, are there new amputations within the next days or executions? He said, no, because we have done some amputations and now we don't need anymore. We don't need them anymore, because the population is doing what we want them to do. And at this moment, when this judge told me, no, you cannot see amputation or execution, I didn't want to see them. I just wanted to know what was happening. One of our IS fighters who was always with us, he told me, oh, if you would like to take a film about amputations or executions, I can do that for you. Our prisons are full with prisoners, and you know, you just have to tell me if you would like to have a Shia or a Kurd, and if you would like to have an amputation or an execution. So you can imagine how difficult these discussions are, these moments are, when you see that somebody is proposing you to kill somebody or to destroy somebody just because he wants to do you a favor. This is a gang of brainwashed terrorists, which is unfortunately extremely dangerous, because the country they have created, the state they have created, is bigger than UK. And therefore, I still think we are underestimating them if we think we just can bombard them and then they will disappear. They will not disappear without bombardments, like the Taliban didn't disappear.
Did you fear for your own safety when you were spending that time with them?
Yeah, we had some difficult moments. Our driver was probably 99% Jihadi John, so you can imagine that you have situations which are difficult. I discussed with them Quran. I told them that I thought that they were un-Islamic. 113 of 114 of the chapters of the surahs of the Quran starts with the words, "In the name of God, the merciful, the most merciful." And I said, "Where is your mercy?" So we had this kind of discussions every day, and they didn't like it at all. But I think if you go to such a place, if you join terrorists, you don't have the possibility and you don't have the right to have too many emotions, because then you have lost. You are lost. If you decide to climb to the Mount Everest, you should think about it if you can do it. Okay. But if you start climbing, then you don't have the possibility to fear it anymore. That's our situation. There was no time to fear anything, no time for emotions. We had to ask questions, we had to open our eyes, we had to write down what we have seen, we had to film what we have seen, and to report it to the world. And, okay. And my message is, this is the most dangerous un-Islamic movement, terrorist movement in the world, in world history. Okay. And we should have more intelligent solutions and in the fighting against them.
Jürgen, we must leave it there. It's fascinating to talk to you. German author and journalist spent 10 days embedded with Islamic State fighters. We appreciate you taking the time to talk to us today. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
More in just a moment.